Thanks everyone for coming out today and being here in San Francisco for Epicenter. I'm very happy to be here. Again, I'm Medha Parlikar from CasperLabs. I'm their Chief Technical Officer. And today I'm going to talk about the Highway Protocol, our new consensus protocol that we've recently released at DevCon 5. And we're also going to talk about the features of the CasperLabs blockchain and why they're important for developers and the space broadly. Before we get started, I'd like to say that today's a rather special day for CasperLabs. It happens to be our first anniversary. We were incorporated, ironically, on Halloween of 2018. And so we're celebrating our first anniversary today. So I'm very excited to be here. So before we, you know, proceed, I'd like to pay homage to the two granddaddies in the space, you know, Bitcoin. We're standing on the shoulders of these giants. Bitcoin introduced the world to crypto economics, and Ethereum built upon this bold idea, creating the idea of programmable money through smart contracts. You know, Ethereum has been wildly successful, but now it's experiencing scaling issues due to its design. Of course, they're working on a solution with Ethereum 2.0, and I'm going to discuss some of the features as part of Ethereum 2.0 that are related to what we're doing at CasperLabs. You know, scale has held blockchain back, and you're probably going to hear about a lot of protocols during this conference and other conferences you attend that are trying to address this scaling issue. And you know, you've got the first generation protocols, Bitcoin and Ethereum, and then now you've seen this new crop of protocols that have attempted to address this scaling problem. And the way they've attempted to address this is by, you know, limiting the validator set size to eliminate consensus overhead, because those messages you know, make a block safe, increase, right, logarithmically or exponentially as the validator set size grows. And but you're sacrificing security and decentralization when you do this. Or you find that they're using optimistic consensus and they just assume that all the validators are honest, because checking for faults in a consensus protocol is expensive and it's hard to do. But blockchain is special because it's a trustless environment. And sacrificing the single value proposition isn't an option for us at CasperLabs. You know, we believe very, very strongly in the decentralized and permissionless nature of blockchain. And we're not going to forfeit that in our design, in our governance processes, anywhere at all in our company. So you talk about scale, and you hear a lot about transactions per second, but that isn't really the reason why scale matters so much. It isn't just about transactions per second, it's about cost. If you can't add capacity to your service, you can't reduce prices and ever gain economies of scale. And this is why we've built CasperLabs, the blockchain for builders. We believe that an innovative consensus protocol that is secured through economics will enable blockchain to scale better without sacrificing security or decentralization. And we want to scale opportunity for everyone forever. These are the pillars that CasperLabs is building upon to build a platform for developers today, but also has the future proof for the long term, so they can have rest assurances that the platform will scale and grow as their needs grow. We will not sacrifice decentralization for scale. We believe that a blockchain can be secured via economic parameters, and we believe in open access to the network for validators, for developers to use languages and tools that are familiar to them, so any developer can work with blockchain technology. And we're building for the future with a protocol that is upgradable through our technology and governance processes. So let's talk a little bit about Casper, the Casper protocol. Who here is familiar with CBC Casper and Casper Research? Okay, great. So Casper represents a family of protocols. The 2017 paper published by Vlad does not attempt to describe a specific protocol. These, they have a specific set of properties that are similar. They're abstract. They have this plurality stake-weighted fork choice rule. Finalization is separate from the protocol and can be done by clients. There is no wasted computation in hashing to solve a puzzle in order to propose a block or a strong, what we call, synchrony constraint. And it's correct in that it has punishments and incentives, so it secures it through economic parameters and lays the basis for economic security. So we're going to dig in a little bit into the structure of Casper. I'll just do a quick short overview here. So you see here four swim lanes. They're depicted in different colors, separate from the Genesis block. These represent validators. Validators are bonded actors that produce protocol messages, and each has a weight based on how much they have bonded. The lines that you see there with errors are justifications. What is depicted here is a simplification of parent justifications. That means I've built this block on top of that other block as a parent, very similar to what you see in Bitcoin and Ethereum today. And it establishes a causal relationship between protocol messages. And it allows for a reasonable notion of this most recent message. Messages can be blocks or votes. And each protocol message builds on top of a block implicitly, and the protocol dictates that you must vote for the most popular block, otherwise that's an invalid block. And in so doing, you vote for that block and its ancestors. An invalid message is called an equivocation. An equivocation is an inconsistent decision, and it is detectable on the network. And it's really impossible to produce by an honest actor. And you know, we consider that detecting these faults and slashing for them is really, really critical in any correct consensus protocol that is based on proof of stake. What you can also observe here is you notice this orange validator joined the network later, and they're attempting to attack what is commonly known in proof of work as a 51% attack. And the interesting thing to note here is while they are building their own chain, their own version of the future, in this particular example, the rest of the network is not following them. They're not sending protocol messages to their block. So those blocks will have a detectable lower level of safety because it only relates to their particular protocol messages. But what's interesting is that in so bonding to the network, they can't affect anything in the history. Right, so the purple block and the blue block that they are building on top of actually become more finalized as a result of the protocol messages that they're sending because they're attempting to build on those blocks. And this is an interesting property of called finalization that is germane to Casper. And this is what you'll see Ethereum 2.0 leveraging in their Casper friendly finality gadget. Basically, the validators will vote for blocks on the beacon chain and finalize those blocks as a result of this property. So we're going to be extending Casper research through this highway protocol. This is a protocol that is both safe and live and does not use proof of work. We believe this protocol is also performant. This paper was authored by Dr. Daniel Kane of UCSD in collaboration with Vlad Zamfir from Ethereum Foundation and Andreas Fackler from Casper Labs. So a quick overview, our desire is to move Nakamoto consensus forward. And here you can see that the protocol is very similar and has a lot of properties to, as proof of work. Vlad was set out to create a proof of stake protocol that preserves a lot of the characteristics of Nakamoto consensus with some key differences. Namely, transactions are finalized, which you've already observed how in the previous slide. Variable safety. Now, this is a property that you do see in Bitcoin and Ethereum. While the ecosystem has chosen to settle on 6 transaction confirmations for finality, you can also choose, if you so wish, to consider a Bitcoin transaction confirmed after 1 or 2 confirmations. You have a very similar property in CBC Casper, which is called a fault tolerance, which reflects the percentage of stake that needs to be reversed or forfeited in order to reverse a decision. So you can choose to have a very low level of safety if your transaction doesn't have a lot of value, right? So if you're transacting for something very nominal or small, you present that transaction to a validator that has a good amount of stake in the network. The probability they're going to revert your transaction and forfeit their stake is very low. And you can consider that transaction finalized almost immediately upon sending the deployment to the network. Something really important about the CBC Casper proof of stake protocol, because we do slash for faults, If an attacker wishes to revert transactions, they will be slashed for it. In proof of work, you can attempt to throw a bunch of hashing power at the network. And if you mount this attack, your only cost is the effort you put in, right? You don't, nobody comes in and takes your rig, right? But in proof of stake, you will lose hundreds of thousands of dollars of stake if you attempt to mount an attack against the network. And that is a real loss that you will experience as a validator. Digging in a little bit more into the highway protocol here. So what we've depicted here are this notion of lanes. They are different from the other notion in the other slide because this is a lane that speaks about the frequency at which validators produce blocks. So what are depicted here are many, many validators, and you can see the rate at which those validators will produce blocks in the protocol. So we have this notion of slow lanes and fast lanes. And in the fast lane, validators produce more blocks at a higher interval. And in the slow lane, they produce blocks more slowly. Validators determine themselves which lane they want to exist in, whether they want to be in the slow lane or the fast lane, based on some cryptographic information. So we have a few notions in our protocol. We have this notion of ticks and rounds. And so a tick is approximately a millisecond, and each tick is assigned to a leader, which is one of the validators. A round will last 2^n ticks for some n, and we'll come back to what this n notion is. And during a round, a validator creates a block if they're the round leader and have not yet produced a block during this round, or they're not the round leader but have already received a block from the round leader, or it's 2/3 of the way through the round, regardless of whether or not we've produced a block yet. Now, these blocks can be either ballots, which are protocol messages voting for a block, or they can be blocks with transactions. And so you can immediately see how we could theoretically scale this out infinitely, where if we had 1,000 validator messages, we can get to a place where each block is voted for by another block, right? And the only dependency we're really stuck with is the amount of bandwidth the leader has to download those blocks. And so this gives us a lot of flexibility to adjust the amount of protocol overhead we have per block and basically do a lot of research around trading off the time to finalization versus the amount of protocol messages we have in order to secure a block. So here's another example of a protocol. This is actually coming from our block explorer. And here you'll see something that looks like a choke point. And you can depict that those two red blocks as the leader in the round. And they have been selected by the protocol to propose a synchronizing block that accepts all the blocks that were in the canonical history. And so if you can look at it, you have this concept of summits. And summits are really where the validators agree on the validity of blocks and vote for messages. And you'll see here that you can almost see layers of agreement, right? So a layer zero summit, a layer one summit, and a layer two summit. And what happens is once those blocks, it's almost like you're building consensus and you're building finality for these blocks. And that choke point, once that block is finalized, everything in the canonical history also becomes finalized. So everything in that past cone becomes finalized. And this gives us some very interesting properties around, one, we're building a directed acyclic graph. You can see here that those blocks are merged, and you have very, very low orphan levels. There's this notion of a quorum as well, because the protocol is partially synchronous. So here you can see that all the validators produce blocks in those rounds. However, because the protocol in the wild will be partially synchronized, you'll have some percentage of those validators participating in each round, depending on whether or not the slower validators are participating in that round. So you can imagine that there will be some percentage of agreement on these blocks as you build up this consensus in summits. From a liveness perspective, if we don't get enough quorum in the summits, the round length gets a little bit longer until we get enough quorum to finalize those transactions. Here you can see some details in the structure of the protocol. We've talked about justification messages, but we've not actually shown them to you. Here you can see there's hashed lines, solid lines, heavy solid lines, and thin solid lines. The thin solid lines are what we call multi-parent. Our protocol does have the ability to merge blocks. We have a very special algebra that shows, basically depicts that these transactions do not conflict, so we can merge them. And the concept of a justification messages means I've seen this block, it's not my parent, but I have included it in my global state, but another block is my parent. So justification messages are ways that validators vote for blocks, as we described earlier in the protocol. So now we're going to talk a little bit about some important details about the CasperLabs blockchain. So from my perspective, I see that consensus protocols will eventually become commoditized. Over time, we're going to find consensus protocols that are going to work very, very well in the space that'll provide both the performance and security and decentralization that the space needs. But then after that, I think it's going to be all about what contract authors can actually use the blockchain to do. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about the features of CasperLabs. We have a very simple and powerful transaction structure. So you'll notice a few things immediately. We have this notion of payment code and session code, and there is no nonce, right? CasperLabs is a Turing-complete system that sends a WASM bytecode. Basically, you can write your applications in any language that compiles down to WASM bytecode, and we will support it. You have this notion of payment code, which is a Turing-complete payment function. And this enables smart contract authors to do really, really interesting things with how their users will pay for deployments and transactions on the chain. So if you want to provide specials and interesting features like debit card functionality, transaction specials, incentives to your users, referral fees, these things are all possible using this special payment code module. We do not use nonce in our deployments because we quickly discovered that nonces were very difficult to manage, so we eliminated them, and we keep track of deployments via our deploy buffer to detect for replay attacks. We have this notion of unforgeable references, and so we believe that dApp developers need to be able to control access to their data and contracts on chain. While we don't support private data, we have this notion of protected data, which is very different. So if you think about parked cars on the street, those parked cars are in the public domain. You can observe them, you can see them, you can observe properties around that parked car, but you're not able to open the cars or drive them, right, without being granted the authority to do so. These references operate in the same way, and it enables contract authors to store data and contracts under a public hash or under a permissioned unforgeable reference, or UREF. And so how would you use this? You would use this in the following manner. Let's say you want to build a relatively complicated contract on chain, but you want to have this notion, you can break up your contract into modularized pieces. And what that means is I may have a block of code that I only want another block of code to have access to. And so if you store that block of code, that smart contract, under an unforgeable reference, you can then use that unforgeable reference in another smart contract to access that contract and access the data stored within that contract. And this speaks to being able to maintain portions of your on-chain code and have pieces that are very modular and create building blocks that are usable and maintainable. We also have this feature known as weighted keys, which is a lot more than just multi-signature. So how weighted keys work with deployments. So weighted keys are this concept of keys that actually have a certain amount of weight or authority granted to them. We have two types of keys in our system. We have deployment keys and management keys for two separate purposes. Management keys you can consider as account management keys, or keys that you would store tokens under, for example. Deployment keys are the keys that you would use to execute or grant authority to run a smart contract. And so here you can see the example of variable weights of keys. You have a key there that has a weight of 10, and you have a smart contract here that has a threshold of 50. So you would need 5 key holders to sign that contract before it can go through and be executed on the blockchain. And there's a lot of very interesting use cases that come out of this. You can think of things like, you know, shareholders signing shareholder actions, right, or voting. Let's say, for example, if for the shareholder proxy action, I need to basically sign something that's based on the number of shares that I hold. My key can be assigned the same number as the number of shares. And just by signing that deployment, I've implicitly voted for that proxy, for that motion, and my signature is recorded on the blockchain when the motion goes through. And this is something that you can build on other blockchains, but it's not as easy or intuitive. Similarly, if a particular threshold is not met, the deployment will not go through, the execution and deployment will not go through. And this gives dApp developers a lot of flexibility in terms of managing access to their contracts. And we learn every single day that there are many, many new interesting applications that can be built on this. We also will be using this to support account recovery. So if you can imagine, you'll have a master key that has a greater weight, that has the authority to recover all of the child keys. And this will enable dApp developers to provide account recovery functions for their end users. So at Casper Labs, we see blockchain as part of a broader system architecture. We don't believe that, you know, applications on the blockchain are going to be wholly held within the blockchain architecture itself. And so we are building tooling and features within the core platform that makes it very easy for dApp developers to integrate blockchain into their broader architecture. We believe that the basic needs of a developer are application insights. So to view the state of my application, the state of my internal variables and debug my application, we've built a GraphQL interface that's available right now online in our Explorer. We believe to be able to maintain their application and providing flexible and possible versioning for dApps and smart contracts, as well as being able to upgrade those contracts. And we also believe that a simple architecture, when you're dealing with complex production systems, the less code you have on your system to deal with the blockchain architecture, the easier it's going to be for you to maintain it and the faster you'll be able to go to market. These features that I've described today are already available in our public developer net. You can experience our public developer net at explorer.casperlabs.io. Our mainnet will be launching in 2020. Thank you very much for your time. Let's start building.